live demonstration, so you'll probably see me with my, you know, hand, you know, like this, and trying to untangle myself from wires and all that. So thanks for your patience, but I hope it'll be something fun. So again, thank you for coming, and I'd like to give a couple shout-outs before I begin. First is the DPRC members. So I have a committee, and they help oversee my project throughout. And so that will be Christopher Taylor, Martha Fisher, Margaret Butler, and Brian Heyer. Thank you so much for your help and your support throughout all of this. And one note about clapping. So there will be intermittent playing throughout. So I'm hoping that instead of clapping after every piece, this recital is already pretty close to the wire. Would you please clap at the end? And I also have a guest here, so if you could also clap for him, just so that we can acknowledge his presence. Thank you. And with that, let's begin. So so this is a lecture about sound. Ultimately, this is kind of a conceptual idea of mine, and it'll hopefully help us to understand a little bit more about sounds that we hear and maybe why we like them as well. So it's widely understood that music is a complex and abstract and enigmatic art form. Despite its centrality to human life, as we all know, music is just as mysterious as it is powerful. In many ways, the complexity of music reflects the complexity of the human mind, and we're all pretty complex. While technology has enabled us to study sounds with a high degree of precision, it does not answer all of our questions about music and musical perception. These questions require knowledge of neuroscience and biology and any other ology you can think of. It's there. It's no wonder this topic eludes comprehension by even people like me who are rabidly curious about these sorts of things. So, in a world that is reaching new technological heights far faster than ever before, due in part to recent advance in AI models and neural networks and the speed of technology, I believe it is now necessary to invest in a deeper understanding of our own humanity. Music is a gateway into the human soul, and it fails to be understood because we're difficult to understand. This lecture recital will introduce some of the fundamentals needed to analyze sound scientifically. These ideas will hopefully shed some light onto the most salient characteristics of piano sound. This lecture will aim to provide some of the basic information to understand my final research project here regarding the general question of what makes sounds musical. Rather than summarizing my research project in this presentation, this evening I intend to provide a springboard into my comprehensive research report set to be completed in fall of 2023. The purpose of this recital is to educate. Rather than to present all of my research all at once, I don't think anyone here would be very happy with that. Including myself. So, in music pedagogy and performance, the word color is used synonymously with timbre. I'm sure many of you are familiar with the word color. We use it in practice, we use it in teaching. Timbre, I think, is kind of the taste of a sound. So it's the difference between an apple and an orange. Or if you've ever pet a puppy, you kind of know how that feels. This is primarily an issue of identification rather than kind of a description. It's our ears telling us what is this sound. Colors in music, however, tend to be pretty relative. So if you've ever heard something, someone describe a sound as silky or vibrant or even rich, perhaps dark, notice that those are all relative descriptions. So we usually don't use like sound-specific things to describe a sound. There are a couple things like shrill or crackly or ringing or gonging. There are some sound or words that we use to describe sounds, but those are largely not used within music performance and practice. As with taste, people tend to blend their personal preferences of sounds with their moral judgments. So with food preferences, sound preferences are reinforced through social and cultural contexts. This is, I believe, where the ambiguity of the word color comes from. We are mixing or scrambling our idea of our moral judgment. Do I like this sound? Is this sound good? With the timbral characteristics or the identification of the sound itself. So, in my opinion, sounds themselves cannot have moral qualities. They just exist. They're a bunch of air particles that are smooshed together with energy, and then our ear takes it, and we understand it through that. But the sound cannot be good or bad by nature. So if you've ever played an instrument like the thunder sheet or even the tam-tam, I've had the chance to play this a couple times in my musical career somehow. Don't ask me how I got there. And this thing can be rattlous. It can be quite scary and even terrifying in some ways, but it can also be compelling. And so, in the right context, these sounds can be musical. Going back to the pedagogical tradition, most instrumentalists are familiar with their respective idea of a beautiful sound. I'm sure we've all heard that. Basically, that's a sound that is more beautiful than another. Otherwise, you wouldn't have that, you know, comparison. So in this case, what does it even mean to be beautiful? Beautiful is a term that's saturated with cultural bias and reinforced through repetition. Institutions select people who can tend to make more beautiful sounds than others. And concert halls select people who you know, favor certain sounds over others. Those are all very culturally reinforced. And also, what we consider as classical musicians, individually with every different instrument, we have a different idea of what a beautiful sound is. Let's say I'm a cellist. I want a rich, maybe milky, some sort of a sound like that. For a pianist like myself, I would want something that sings or rings, perhaps. Maybe something that emulates the human voice as much as possible. So there are differences to how we each describe a beautiful sound. To understand where those inclinations come from, we have to understand the observable aspects of a sound. So basically, a sound wave is a pressure vibration that moves through a medium. Most of the time it's air or it's water. You can actually hear sounds underwater, but most of us don't live underwater. So whenever these vibrations occur through energy, a molecule is at rest, the energy pushes it, goes away, and then it comes kind of back to its resting point. And one of these becomes one vibration, and one vibration per second is one hertz. So a hertz is how many vibrations happen per second. That's essentially what we have in a sound. However, most sounds are extremely complicated. They have a number of combinations of frequencies, and that's what kind of a timbre is. It's a combination of multiple different sine waves being the most basic of a wave. So imagine that a string is vibrating. So if you have a string stretched from this point, and the string is throughout the middle, and you pluck it just perfectly in the center, where there's not even like a little hitch where your finger is. Imagine if you plucked it perfectly, then you can get what you call the fundamental, or the lowest frequency. And this is kind of the main pitch that we hear. Unfortunately, maybe fortunately or unfortunately, most of us don't have that kind of aim and that kind of precision. So if you pluck something, it's not going to be directly in the middle. You'll get a bunch of different points, and because of that, you will have your string vibrating in kind of different points. And this creates complexity within your string wave. Actually, that creates overtones, because these ends, if a string is held to an end and you pluck the string, the only way it can vibrate is kind of mathematically restricted. And so overtones are mathematically proportionate to the fundamental wave. So I know it's complicated. It is for me too. Basically, your ear is a miracle. It translates all these various complex sound waves into one thing. It's called timbre. So your ear essentially does a kind of an analysis, and it shows you what that is. Okay. So to give you an example of this, I prepared one of these. I just got this off of Wikipedia, but it's very exciting. Just make sure that the audio won't blow your ears off. And this is what you call a triangle wave. I, to be honest, I've had this wave explained to me multiple times. I don't understand it. It's a wave, and it kind of sounds like a computer sound. But there are a couple different elements inside it. So here is the simplest of the triangle wave. Kind of sounds like you need to fix your dial up. And then on the right here is what we call an additive triangle wave. So instead of the sound being presented to you all at once with one flavor, this example now adds every single wave to create that sound. And notice how the sound eventually merges from the simplest into the most complex, which is what you hear on the left. So this one transforms into the one on the left. So I just find that to be interesting. Our ear does that kind of automatically. You hear a bunch of small little sounds, and then they add up into kind of a more complex sound. So that is the overtonal difference, I suppose. Does this mean that we tend to enjoy sounds with more complexity, with more spectral, convolution? Not exactly, because sounds with too much noise tend to be what we call a noise. So something that has way too much activity, maybe like a hammer hitting an anvil, that is considered noise, and we tend to think that's bad, in certain contexts. We do usually tend to enjoy sounds that contain a pitch. So even if say that you're playing a percussion instrument like a triangle, or like you're playing a bongo in an orchestra somehow, we tend to like those instruments to be tuned in an appropriate way to that orchestra as well. So we tend to prefer things that have more of a pitch. So classical musicians like myself are particularly concerned with the idea that we want to have as much detailed control over the timbre or just the final product of the sound as possible. I'm sure many of us can relate to that. We are insistent upon having a certain type of sound. Ironically, my instrument is one that provides me with the least amount of timbral control, as opposed to, let's say, a cello or a brass instrument, where you have kind of active control over the sound as it comes out. But unfortunately, we don't have that. The hammer, basically, once you launch the hammer with your finger and it hits a string, no one can change that sound of the string. So it's quite a limited mechanism. We can't vibrato, we can't do, we can stop the sound in the middle using the pedal, but that'll be kind of later on. So we don't have as much control over the sound. But while this might suggest that our instrument is limited and perhaps inferior, we have a couple ways to craft these complex sounds to make up for that. And the main thing is when we have digits, we have 10 of them, most of us at least, and we also have the use of the damper pedal, which is the right pedal there. It allows us to hold sounds, and it also has a couple of other fun little side effects. Sheet May Safely Graze is a good example of a piece requiring fine polyphonic control and a discerning foot. This piece was originally composed as a soprano aria in a cantata by Bach, titled This Thing.
I'm going to prevent this from controlling what happened there. There we go.
Tell was mir behagt ist nur die Munterjagd. And that's as good as I'll get. So this was a cantata, or part of a cantata, that was arranged for many different instruments. The original was for the soprano voice and two flutes, and then the continuo. So very simple, but there are about four instruments at play there. And of course, you have arrangements like the one that's by Academy of St. Martin in the Fields, who kind of expand this arrangement into different orchestras, and they kind of reimagine it. So I'm going to go ahead and play the original here. Hopefully we can get this going. I'll rewind this. So beautiful. But this is kind of the simplest form. That's how Bach had originally arranged it. And so here is the orchestral version reimagined. There that the now the voice has been replaced with the violin, and I think it's quite a tasteful arrangement. There we go. So as one might imagine, the transition from a larger chamber ensemble to the piano is quite a challenge for a pianist. Every note in an active texture kind of needs to be controlled in some way so that we don't just get a barrage of sound. And so that is where a sensitive pianist, hopefully, will curate those elements of sound, and so kind of mix the sound to make it pleasing. And this is what we call voicing. We're controlling individual notes within a texture of sound. So this iconic melody is, I'm sure you've heard it in weddings, is written for flute and soprano voice, and this is a challenge for pianists because they're wind instruments, and the vocal pipes are also wind instruments. So we have to somehow make this sound like a wind instrument, or at least reminiscent of a wind instrument. At the same time, the piano is a kind of a string and percussion instrument, so we can't sneak into the sound, we can't sustain it, there are a lot of things we can't do. Mr. Petrie, Egon Petrie, handles this issue quite well, actually. The flute and the voice are given to the fifth finger in the thumb here. Notice in the top staff there, the voice is relegated to the thumb, and then the flutes are kind of in the top, and they happen at the same time. And this way, the thumb, which is quite thumpy, gets to have a very thick sound. And then the soprano is on the top, they have a lighter sound with the two weaker fingers on the hand. So let me give you an example of this, and we'll kind of see how that works. This is kind of the main method for how we deal with these orchestral arrangement issues. We find clever ways to get around it. Another issue is that of stylistic interpretation. There are numerous different arrangements of Sheep May Safely Graze, including the piano version I'll be doing. And they were written with a bunch of different intentions in mind, from trying to be faithful to the original by not adding too much, and then there are others that try to add their own personal style to the music. Petrie's is arranged in kind of a stereotypical romantic way, so usually it's played with a lot of pedal, a ton of voicing on the top, and kind of, a lot of like refined chord voicing and stuff. So basically like every accompanimental note is used to kind of support that soaring melody line. So this is the challenge that you have to face kind of as you're dealing with color in music. So what lets all this happen is the pedal. The pedal is the magic part of the instrument, and Arthur Rubinstein, Anton Rubinstein, excuse me, called the pedal the soul of the piano. So the pedal's resonance is kind of what allows these aspects to come together. What we call sympathetic resonance occurs whenever you put the pedal down, and then every single damper that's on the string kind of allows every string to freely vibrate. And this actually has a tangible effect on the sound. It creates this cushion, and the reason for that is called sympathetic resonance. Basically, if there's a sound vibration, if you've ever seen a video of someone crack a wine glass with a human with their own voice, that's because the wine glass has a natural resonance frequency, and their voice, if they do it right, they can actually make the glass vibrate kind of sympathetic resonance. And so this is kind of what happens within the piano. And the effects, as we will probably end up seeing later, will actually be tangible, and we can see that. So normally, this is kind of what makes our piano sound colorful. It gives us what we call kind of a wetness. Many of us use that in pedagogy. This is kind of the wet part of the sound. And it's kind of like laying down a blanket underneath, underneath something. It makes you feel comfortable. So whenever these strings have these reverberating waves, again due to that natural resonance, it creates like a complexity to the sound that we tend to enjoy. So this is where we will get a little bit technical. This is I'm going to be using a piece of software. I'm going to drag it over here just so you can see what I'm looking at. This is called Cakewalk. It's a free piece of software, but it has a couple nice usages that I can exploit here. One is that I can slow down a clip. So a clip can be, if I have, I'm going to be showing you a piano note, played normally, and I can slow it down by a factor of 10. And I can also use what's called a plugin, certain types of plugins to help me kind of like augment or even look at the sound. So I have a spectral analyzer here, which will help me to observe the sound. So what I have is, this is a C4, which is this note. I recorded this from Professor Taylor's studio, and here is the sound by itself. I can hopefully You may have heard that millions of times within your life. And so what I can do now is I can enable a stretch. Now I can stretch it to a factor of 10. Here's the slowest. So maybe not the most pleasant sound. Maybe it is. Who knows? But what I can also do here is open up a spectrogram. So this is a plugin that allows me to see the sound. On the x-axis, which is the bottom, you'll see frequencies, a number of different frequencies laid out from about 20 to about 20,000 or 20 kilohertz. And then for the x-axis, it's amplitude, meaning volume. So you'll see certain things be louder than others. So here it is. And what I'm going to do at the same time here is I'm going to be zooming in on certain fundamentals so you can kind of hear what the sound is comprised of. I'm going to focus specifically on the fundamental and maybe even go up to the seventh. So here's the sound. This is essentially the power of the overtone. We have all these other, like a sound has so much complexity in it, and our ear just kind of gives it to us conveniently. So it's quite a miraculous thing. So, let me get rid of this. Sorry, I predicted this would happen. Here we go. So I've taken a couple preliminary spectrograms with C4, with the note that you've heard, with and without the pedal now. So notice that within this diagram, you see a couple sticks. Of course, those are the same sticks that represent the overtones. And the fundamental there, C4, 261 hertz, that is the primary overtone that gives you the pitch of the sound. Notice here on the right, there are a bunch of tiny little spikes on the bottom, and those are parts of the resonance of the string that kind of muddy up the sound, but also makes it sound complex. Here is a pedaled sound. So I'll flip back maybe twice here. Here's the pedaled sound, unpedaled. So quite a lot of difference here. Notice especially on the right side where you find the higher frequencies, there's quite a lot more activity. You'll see also kind of in the middle range, and all throughout, that there are these kind of spikes that seem to come out from under, about halfway up the screen. And really the only difference between this sound and this sound is that there is pedal added into it. So it's only one sound, or it's only one note, but I'm using pedal in one, I'm not using the other. So this is the effect of sympathetic rate resonance. I've combined the slides here, just so you can kind of see. It's a little bit messy, but notice that the one that's kind of in the background more, it's a lot higher up, and so you'll hear the difference in the sound. And that is sympathetic resonance. Let's go ahead and hear the whole piece. And as you listen, I hope that you'll kind of listen to these interactions between the voice and the flute and how the pedal provides a little cushion for you as you listen. So here we go. comparing the music, the piano to another instrument can provide some fascinating insights. The cello is a bowed instrument, for example, that vibrates throughout these wound metal strings. The bowing action of a cello provides some key distinctions that set it apart from the piano. First of all, the initial attack, since you have a bow, you don't have to, you know, percussively hit it, you can very slowly make the sound happen. And so the not only can you maintain contact with the bow, but you can also control how fast the attack is. And also the position of the bow on the string, or vice versa, the position of the string on the bow can provide some timbral differences, which the best cellist can kind of manage. So here, I'm going to give you another example. This is a, this will be a cello string, the A string that I recorded prior to this recital. And let me just make sure that all this stuff is there. So we will kind of be observing this. Let's see, there we go. And here is the sound just as is. We've all heard that in orchestra concerts. It's the first note that we are tuning to. So let's go ahead and slow this down by a factor of 10. So lots of things here going on. I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna restart this, and we'll observe. You'll notice here that compared to the piano sound, the harmonics kind of towards the end, the partials are much more active and they're louder. And so this is a characteristic feature of the sound. So I do have a comparison point here. So let's get this window. There we go. Okay, so here is the cello. Sound that we just saw, I captured it. It kind of looks different. Go ahead and ignore the blue. The blue just means the left channel, but the right is a lot more poignant here. Lots of activity there on the right side. And there are a couple dips in the middle, but especially the higher frequencies are much higher. Okay, here is the piano for reference. So quite a different spectrum. Even though they're both metal strings, there's a huge impact on the sound based off of how you play it. And obviously the strings are different, made out different things as well. So Chopin's Etude, Opus 25, number 7, also known as a cello etude, provides us with a convenient method of comparing these two instruments. Chopin modeled his etude off of an opera by Bellini. I believe this was actually the year that Bellini passed away, and so he wrote this piece kind of within the same time period. But this was within his opera Norma, his Act 2. So today we have someone who can demonstrate this melody. If we could have Aaron, I'm not sure if I can. There you are. Yeah, there we go. We can demonstrate this melody on the cello unaccompanied. We have a version of it here for us to hear. And this one will be actually in the key of E minor. It won't be in the same key. But yeah, what I would like to do actually for this is maybe a little bit different. I'm going to have to break character here for a second. We have another tablet. This is a spectrogram. Currently active, that is a little bit different than the one we've been using. This is purely for aesthetic enjoyment. This one moves as things go on from right to left, so time is kind of moving from the x-axis. You'll notice that the frequencies are now on the y-axis, and that's kind of all you need to know. So, Aaron, if you could play the first four bars of the melody. Excuse me, one more time. I gotta play this. Here we go. Go for it. This same excerpt here, and we are going to leave this on just for this part, and then I'll turn it off later. the upper range, the upper frequencies are a lot more active on his instrument than on mine. And yet Chopin wants me to sound like a cello. It's unheard of. It's evil. Anyways, so what I'd like to do here is I'm going to turn this off and hopefully get back into this presentation. Same spot. There we go. And you know what? I have to do this. One moment here. This is the problem with kind of a more complex presentation. I have to do a little bit more magic in front of you. There we go. So now I'd like to do a comparison point of the actual music. I'll be playing the solo piece written by Chopin, and then Aaron and I will play the etude by a guy named Glazunov. Let me just there you go. So you'll notice that you'll listen that Glazunov, the person who's arranged this for piano and cello, has had kind of some different ideas. The same issue with the arrangements in the past, timbre and register tend to be the problem. So Glazunov has actually made some fixes to this music. You'll notice in the Chopin, which is the excerpt on the top, that there are a lot of stepwise motions, a lot of chromatic motion, and Glazunov instead opts for a lot of leaps, especially in that second measure, to showcase kind of a sweeping, broad gesture. So as we play this, I hope that you'll be listening to how each of our instruments capitalize kind of on the, how each of us as musicians capitalize on the strengths of our instruments and how these arrangements differ from one another. So again, I'll be playing the solo, and then Aaron and I will both play the arrangements.
Thank you.
progenitor of water music on the piano. I'm sure you've heard of Jadot by Ravel, or even Debussy has composed some of these more watery sounds pieces of music. And so they are all, in some way or form, they're borrowing from this piece. And so my thought is that he's the first one to do this, and yet it's quite complex and very specific. How did he do that? Where did his ideas come from? Here's an example of a watery passage. It's actually the beginning of the piece, and much of what we associate now with impressionistic water music. So if this is a romantic piece, the pieces that happen after Liszt's time that are more impressionistic, that impersonate water or imitate water, it's all derived from things that you can hear from here, or most of it is. So notice here the cyclical accompanimental textures. It's very rapid, they are repetitive, and they all kind of abide by an extended diatonic harmonic language. Notice here the C sharp on the bottom in the first measure, and then it kind of ends with an arpeggiated C sharp 9 chord, is what we call it now. And so notice also that this is in the higher register of the range. Liszt was the one who decided that a water droplet should be represented in the higher range somehow. Then I've taken the liberty of showing you a water droplet run through my cakewalk application. So if you've never seen one, here's how it sounds first. Yeah. Oh, excuse me. That last one there, the last pitch is actually a C sharp, which is what you kind of see here. So notice here on the spectrogram that especially in the high register, very vibrant. You don't really see a lot of holes in here, and that's because it's kind of more of a noise. So the sound is muddy, it's dirty. On the lower registers or lower frequencies, you don't hear as much. It's just the quality of the sound. Here is a C4 from earlier. And so this is a spectrogram that you've seen in the past. Here's the comparison, of course. Notice here that again, the upper range on the piano is a lot more subdued, but there's a little bit more perhaps complexity going on. The peaks are a lot more distinct than here. It's more fun in some ways. I mean, it's not very similar to just compare the C note to water droplets. So why not compare it to Liszt? This is the about the first measure, maybe a little bit past there, where you're hearing the first C sharp 9 arpeggiated chord. You'll find maybe it looks a little bit more similar to that water droplet. Notice that the block of sound kind of in the middle area there, it's a lot more full. There's a lot less kind of spikeage going on. The upper register is a lot more active too, although not quite as much. So let's see what happens when we compare these two spectrograms. It actually turns out to be pretty similar. Notice here in the middle register, there's kind of a peak that goes up. Generally, the right side tends to drop off a little bit, but it's not too unfamiliar. And on the left side, you'll see that it drops off in a very similar way. So I'd like to think that Liszt knew something about water droplets when he was composing them. Of course, there's no evidence, but I can dream, can't I? There are some similarities, perhaps, in the subject matter. Of course, a lot of what Liszt is demonstrating here is metaphorical. So rather than literal, instead of trying to impersonate water, which would not happen either easily, here Liszt is drawing kind of imagery of water, not just as a smooth kind of arpeggiated sound, but also as a staccato figure in the right hand. So very cyclical, lots of notes, but now it's staccato. So evidently Liszt was experimenting with the different types of ways you can explore a water droplet sound. So I'd like to suggest that he was being kind of cheeky when he was composing this piece. So Debussy also wrote a piece, or maybe even a couple pieces, that reflect water. This is Reflets dans l'eau, and its translation is Reflections on the Water, but it uses a lot of Liszt techniques in here. So Reflections on the Water, this is what Debussy thinks about water. Notice that instead of those crazy passages, which you will find some of those crazy passages in Debussy, but Debussy decides to start with something larger. There are larger gestures. You'll see kind of a wave as opposed to a trickling, babbling brook. And towards the end here, this is around at the end of the piece, the droplets are kind of slower. They're more isolated. They're sustained. modern music is kind of developing over time. Here is an excerpt in the Debussy that is actually similar to a passage in Liszt Jadot. Notice that this passage also uses the higher registers to great effect, and this is kind of the shimmery sort of sound that you get both in the Liszt and in the Debussy. So, what I'd like to do here is, this is probably one of the last times, I think, when we're going to go into this, but I've fed through my cakewalk application a water kind of wavy sound. So this is slightly different than what you've heard in the past. Let me just make sure everything's good here. And here is the spectrogram. I'm going to have to do this. This is slightly different than what you've seen before. There's a different analyzer, but same results here. There we go. So as you're watching, you notice that kind of almost looks like water. There are kind of parts that are sticking out individually, but there's no pattern. A lot on the top frequencies, a little bit less on the lower frequencies. So quite a bit of activity is very natural. Kind of cool to watch, I would say. Almost like a fireplace. So here is a spectrogram now, in the same breath, of the Debussy passage I just showed you. And what I'd like you to notice is kind of the sporadic nature of the spectrogram. It's kind of a visual spectacle, but was going for when he was composing this piece. I'm sure that Debussy wasn't trying to reflect exactly water, but this was a metaphorical, perhaps, description of the water. There you go. I'm going to close out this here. And we're back. Okay. So, this kind of, you know, it's not all that surprising that the spectrograms that we see of the Debussy don't exactly line up with the spectrograms of the water. I think actually Debussy would be pretty appalled if his impressionistic work, which is supposed to be misty and suggestive, is all of a sudden extremely similar to this water droplet or this wave. Debussy's impressionism is built on the idea of artistic kind of obscurity, and so I think Debussy would be quite happy to know that the spectrogram doesn't line up quite well. So that concludes the lecture portion. I'd like to conclude this recital with a performance of those two last pieces in reverse order. So I'll start with the Debussy and I'll end with the Liszt just for programmatic reasons. But as I listen again, or as you listen, I invite you to note the differences and similarities between Liszt and Debussy's piece, as well as the different goals that each composer strived towards composing each work and how Debussy seems to kind of like latch on to Liszt's ideas and develop them in new ways. So that's it. Thank you for coming, and I will conclude this program with two pieces. So I hope you'll enjoy.